Well, thanks for attending today. My name is Alwin Veen. I'm the sales manager of Varonis in the Netherlands. My goal today for you guys is to tell you something about Varonis, to tell you something how we help our customers to protect their data, and how does that relate to GDPR? Because, well, I think it's GDPR are the magic four letters from last year. New regulations are coming to us. What does it mean for me? What does it mean for me as a company? And what do we need to do? And yesterday in our presentation at the main stage, I was together with Lovisa Bonivier from SecureLink, and she told us something about the GDPR and what do we need to change. And she told a very interesting story about how to handle GDPR. Most of the time we are talking about compliancy. We have to be compliant. And the question there was, is being compliant the only thing I need to do to protect my data? Can it be possible that if all checkboxes in the compliancy are checked, that still my data is being leaked? And I think that's the main question today for every security officer, but also for every CEO, every IT manager, and all other roles within the company. Because data security is something from everyone, for the whole team, for the whole company. And that's what we as Varonis are trying to tell to our customers, and we want to help them to really protect the data from the inside out. So not protecting like we don't want strange people, weird people, mad people, evil people to come in. No, if they are in and we don't see it, what can they do? And how can we prevent them from stealing our data? So, I want to tell you a bit of background about our company, Varonis, and I want to show you the topics I just mentioned. So that's the agenda for today. Where does Varonis come from? Varonis is started by Jaki Fetelsen and Oad Korkus, and they were engineers at NetApp. So they were storage specialists, and they came to TotalEMP in Angola, and they had a data leakage. And the data leakage was that a few of their pictures that are made from the ocean bottom, which are very expensive pictures because a robot has to dive under the water, they were gone and they didn't know what happened. Was the data leaked? Was it by accident deleted? Or was it stolen by a competitor? And half a year of research resulted in the fact that they didn't know it and they will never find out. And that's why Jaki said, we need to build something for this. We need to be in control over that data. And that's where Varonis started. So if we're talking about a data breach, and there are a lot of data breaches over the last time, we see a lot of things they have in common. And what's the one thing that's really in common of all those data breaches? Is that it was all stolen from the unstructured data platforms. File service, mail environments, SharePoint environments, the SharePoint Online, Exchange Online, all those environments where data is unstructured, where data rights are set via Active Directory groups, those data is being stolen. But why? I have an example. These are some facts about the Sony data breach. There were a lot of files stolen. And the consequences were also huge, financially, but also, you know, the, how do you say it? The damage about, you know, how people think about Varonis, about Sony was really, really, reputation damage, there it is, was really big. But how did this happen? First of all, they got intruded. So someone broke into the network and nobody saw it, because they used insider credentials. Insider credentials were stolen. How do you do that? Social engineering, fire the front desk, etc., etc. There are a lot of ways to get in with just regular credentials. And with malware, they accelerated and they mapped the network. And then they got more rights and more rights and more rights. And in the end, they leaked data. This is normal. This is a normal kill chain procedure to leak data, to steal data from a company who is very very important to the market. So basically what we want to do is we want to see that, we want to get alerted on that, but we don't have the tools as of now, because there's no audit trail, there's no permission visibility, we don't know where our crown jewels are, we don't know which data is highly classified, we don't know it, so we cannot see it. But we want to see it. We want to investigate. If there are alerts that someone is breaking into my network, I want to know that. I want to be alerted and I want to investigate what's going on there. I want to see all the events that's happening. File opens, file changes, permission changes. For instance, a service account. If a service account, which is being used by software, is not behaving like a robot, but like a human, it should be hacked, right? So that's what I want to know. I want to know what my users normally do. I want to have a baseline. Because if I want to know abnormal behavior, I must be sure what's normal behavior. That's what I want to measure. So how does this relate to GDPR? We need to be compliant. We need to be secure. We need to tell instances that we had a data breach. So we have to know there was a data breach, right? So think of this. Every company has the usual suspects within them. Every company. We have people that are infected by malware. We have people that are not that happy on their chair. And they maybe want to do something to the company. We maybe have hijacked Hillary. She's been hijacked. And we maybe have the abusive admin Andy. And the abusive admin Andy, that can be a student within our outsourcing partner's office who gets a lot of money to steal data. That's abusive admin Andy. So what we see is that when we have the insider threats there and we have data breaches, and there was a data breach, that most of the companies even didn't know that there was a data breach, 45%. We see that it costs us a lot of money when the data is being leaked, when we have that breach. And we see CEOs are being fired because of the fact data is being leaked. So the risks are really, really up to the high level now known, and we need to act on it. And what are the most important questions to make sure we can build in some security about data leaks? These are those questions. Who has access? Who can access? Who did have access? But also, where are my crown jewels? Which data is sensitive? And where is it stored? Who is the owner of the data? It is, for me, it's very clear that a financial director or a CFO, he is the owner of the financial data, and not the IT department. But why is it that an IT director gets fired because someone could have access to financial data? This is strange. We need the business, we need them to help us, and IT needs to facilitate in a controlled way, in a secure way. So what does Varonis do for this? We automate, we measure, and we make sure that all those information can be available with our technology. So we measure which people do we have, in which groups are they, and how are the groups nested. We measure all permissions, all, every single folder we know, who has access out of which group, which access do they have, and which groups are nested, and are they inheriting folders or not. We measure all activity, everyone who touches a file, who copies it, who changes permissions, we will know, and we will put it in our metadata database. And also we classify the existing information, so we know where are PII data, where is financial data, etc., etc. And then, when we have all those measurements in place and we have those information, we need to work with that information. So we have the three most typical steps we use, which is detect, prevent, sustain. So first we have to know where are we now. Do we have problems? Do we have folders with global access? And which data is in that folder? Etc., etc. Then we have to prevent, make sure that the right people have access to the right data. We have to make sure that if people are exceeding their credentials, we get alerted. And then we have the sustain phase, and that's how we automate things. So if someone wants to have rights, we need to have a process in place, because the people in the business want to do the primary task and not give access to people. So, a little bit more in detail. In the detect phase, we map the complete environment. That's also what hackers do in the reconnaissance phase. So why don't we do it first so that we know where the gaps are, so we are earlier than the hackers? So we see which folders are there, where's the global access, and we bring everything in place. We see where are my classified files. We see everything. And after that, we start auditing. Who is using which data? And this tells us the baseline also. So if you want to have a profile of a user, of his normal behavior, this is where we do it. And we do it every day, in and out. And after that, we're going to alert. And these are just examples. We have like around 70 behavioral rules now in our software. And those behavior rules will alert on suspicious behavior. And suspicious behavior can be something like this. GPO policies that are being changed. I want to know that, who is doing that. But also if someone put 10 emails on marked as unread in a mailbox where he's not the owner, this is also suspicious behavior. And those are really detailed things. But we will also see ransomware infections. And we will kill it. And we tell the admin, those are the files that's being encrypted. So this is really valuable. It will save us time, and it will save us eventually also money. Then the prevent phase. Here is where we lock down all permissions. So we will get rid of all this global access. We will work together with the business. We will see who is the owner. Because if we see who is using data, they can tell us if this data is sensitive and who is basically the owner. And this is not this is a very common issue. Because, you know, within the bigger companies, we have a lot of mergers and we have a lot of filers which we have to manage, which we didn't build. We have a lot of history in our Active Directory, users that are inactive or not necessary anymore, or not working at the company anymore, but still active. We have data rights of people who were unique on a folder placed, and they have left the company, they were out of the Active Directory, and there's a security identifier on the folder. And those rights can still be used, and hackers are looking for that rights. And in a lot of time, it's also admin rights, full control permissions. It's crazy, we need to get rid of them. So eliminate the global access. With the bi-directional visibility of rights, we can see we have a group everyone, and in the group everyone, which was used at the target data leak by an airco engineer, he put his laptop in an outlet, and he leaked 70,000 files out of the everyone group. With Varonis, it was never happened, because we will find the everyone group, and we will remove it when it's necessary, because we talk to the business and we cooperate with the business. Excessive permissions. Why should we have permissions and folders for people that are not using the data? Just ask yourself, why do we have, for instance, 100 terabytes of data, and we see that 80% of the data is not being used? Every IT admin I talk to and I ask him, how many of your data is used? Sometimes they say, oh, maybe 10 or 15%. So we have 80% of data, 80% of data storage, 80% of backup costs, 80% of management costs. And we're not using the data. And as of today, with the GDPR, we have 80% of risk of data leakage, of data we will not know if it's sensitive or not. And it can be leaked because we have it and it's active. And people can access it. So why not only a least privilege model, but also a least data model? Just put it away, put it on a hard disk, remove all rights, people will not see it anymore. And if they're not complaining, we just lost a major risk and a major cost. We also have to remove all the technical issues that Microsoft provides us when we have NTFS rights. So broken ACLs, folders with unique permissions, you know, the user ACEs, unresolved SIDs, which I just mentioned. We can all remove them because we'll just look them up and get them out. And we will help you with data modeling as well. If we remove this group, who will access, who will lose their access rights, who is actually using those rights? So we will just point out the guys and the girls who are using this data, so you will not harm the business. But you can remove 80% of all those rights. The sustain phase. This is the last phase. This is where we automate. This is where we help the data owners to just see what's going on their data, who is asking access, who is having access, and who is using access. It's just via a portal. It's really easy to use. This is how we. This is the, this authorization model works. So it's just an easy workflow platform. It's a web-based platform, and people are logging on to that to request access, and data owners are approving and setting access. So IT is just only monitoring what's going on, and if something suspicious is going on, they will get alerted. And then it's archiving and data migrations. We also have to automate that. When I talk to IT managers, I talk to them a lot of the times they are saying to me, you know, Alwin, it's really hard to do a migration because, you know, we have such a large amount of data and I don't know if I want to have it on my new storage. It's really expensive storage. And then they say, I don't know what to do with the data rights. If I use a robocopy or an xcopy tool, sometimes I see creator owner rights, I don't know it anymore. What do we have to do? So why not automate? If we know which permissions are now, why not set them on the new platform as well and do it automatically? That's how we help. Also, we can tell you which data still, which it not has to be migrated. So this is where you can do a big step in your data governance and also in your data security. Going back to the detect phase, this is where everything starts, right? We have a situation right now and we are not in control. We can help you to get in control. Use our software, do a free risk assessment, use our consultants, do a free risk assessment. We will bring everything in place for you. It only takes 4 hours, only takes one server and one space in a SQL database. That's the only thing we need. And we will bring it in place for you. And we will measure 1 or 2 months and we will show you the risks. And we will show you how your environment is right now. And this is where you can decide, okay, this is something we need to use or not. I want to do it for you. That's basically my story. I got 1 minute left. So maybe if someone has a question, you can ask. Nobody? Then I want to thank you all for your presence. Thank you very much.